The giant salamander may look like a mythical river monster, but they're more bark than bite.
Hi, I'm Danielle, and you're watching Animal Logic.
Giant salamanders are a river-dwelling family of amphibians called Cryptobranchidae, and as you may have guessed, they occupy 3 of the 4 slots for largest amphibians in the world.
Their name means hidden gills, which refers to the specialized way that they absorb oxygen.
Instead of gills, they absorb oxygen through very small tubes located on the side of their frills, called capillaries. In order to maximize surface area and intake of oxygen, they have folds of skin around their neck.
Living in rivers is key, as they need a consistent flow of fresh, oxygenated water to survive.
While there used to be many more, only 3 species of giant salamander remain: the giant Japanese and Chinese salamanders, and the fantastically named hellbender, which is found in the United States.
When Western scientists first discovered giant salamander fossils, they thought that they were humans that had died during the great biblical flood.
I don't know what they thought humans looked like, but it would have made for a pretty freaky looking person. As a nod to that early misunderstanding, the genus to which the giant Japanese and Chinese salamanders belong is named Andreas, which means image of a man.
Giant salamanders don't undergo a full metamorphosis, and the adults still retain gill slits.
Unlike most amphibians, giant salamanders are fully aquatic. Usually, as amphibians grow, they develop lungs and then become terrestrial. Giant salamanders don't do this, even though they do have lungs, which they use primarily for buoyancy. They have very poor vision and instead rely on photoreceptors all over their bodies to tell them when they're exposed or hidden in the shade. For hunting, they have a lateral line, which is an organ along the side of their bodies that detects vibration like a passing fish.
They're primarily nocturnal and are excellent at hiding, as they essentially look like long slippery rocks.
It took us about a half an hour to find one in a relatively small aquarium. Their flattened shape is an adaptation for living in running water, as they offer less resistance than more rounded creatures. Hellbenders are the only extant member of their genus, and are the only members of the giant salamander family living in the wild of North America, primarily in the eastern United States. Hellbenders are the smallest of the giant salamanders, measuring up to 75 centimeters long and weighing up to 5 pounds. They are the 4th heaviest amphibian in the world.
They get their name because early settlers thought that they were so ugly, they must be creatures from hell. I don't entirely agree. I mean, look at them, they're so squishy.
Despite having a tail that seems purpose-built for swimming, they don't swim all that often, and instead opt for walking around along the river floor. They seem to use their tail primarily for short bursts of speed. They spend the majority of their time hiding under rocks, waiting for prey to pass by, around 90% of which is crayfish.
Unlike their Asian cousins, hellbenders only have one lung, which they use for buoyancy control.
During breeding season, the late summer and early autumn, hellbenders change colors slightly, from brown to reddish brown. They breed like fish. The male will court the female, she'll lay her eggs, about 700, and the male will fertilize them. Females will lay eggs every 2nd or 3rd year.
Males reach sexual maturity at 5 years, and the females at 7 years. It's unknown how long they live in the wild, but in captivity, they live up to 30 years.
Giant Chinese salamanders are found in a large but fragmented range across China and are the largest of the 3 giant salamanders. They are also the largest amphibians in the world, and they can measure up to 1.8 meters long and can weigh up to 30 kilograms.
5'4" over here.
Not only are they much larger than hellbenders, but they can live much longer as well. In captivity, they can live up to 60 years.
While hellbenders may have won out on the cool name front, the giant Chinese salamander definitely takes the cake for creepiest name.
They're known to locals as infant fish, in part due to their size, but primarily because they can vocalize, produce hisses, barks, and cries that resemble the cries of a small child. Giant Chinese salamanders are generalists and will eat anything that they can catch, including other giant salamanders.
Giant Japanese salamanders are very similar to their Chinese cousins.
They are slightly smaller, but the main difference is that their heads are covered in tubercles. We're not entirely sure why they have tubercles, but it's possible that they use them for better camouflage in the rivers of southwest Japan, or to increase the surface area that they have to absorb oxygen. In Japan, they are also called giant pepperfish, due to their ability to excrete a milky substance that smells like Japanese peppers when they are threatened. Mmm, yum.
Hellbenders and giant Japanese salamanders are near threatened, while giant Chinese salamanders are critically endangered.
Their numbers have decreased by 80% in the last 45 years, and there are now between 20 and 50,000 of them left in the wild. The main reason for their population loss is damming, pollution, and overcollection. They're considered a delicacy, and they're used in traditional Chinese medicine. Though there is good news, China has established 17 natural reserves to help protect them in the wild. Hellbenders are suffering from similar issues like habitat destruction and pollution, but efforts are now being made to reintroduce them into areas where they were once pushed into extinction, specifically in western New York, offering new life for an amazing species on the brink. The Cryptobranchidae family has been around for a long time, and there are fossils of their ancestors that are over 160 million years old. Based on those fossil records, we know that in all this time, giant salamanders haven't changed very much and still closely resemble their ancient ancestors.
Due to this lack of change, they were likely deemed not scary enough to make the cut for any of the Jurassic Park movies, which is a real shame. As a paleoartist, there's a lot of things that I kind of wish that the Jurassic World movies did better. But don't take it from me, take it from the experts at Wisecrack. They just published a video that explores what went wrong with Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. It explores how the original Jurassic Park crafted its amazing action scenes and how they compare to the new films. If you like learning the deeper meaning behind your favorite TV shows, movies, and video games, then I think you'll love Wisecrack. Click here to visit their channel, and click here to go and watch their Jurassic World video. Make sure to tell them Animalogic sent ya. What animal should I check out next? Please let me know in the comments, and be sure to subscribe for new episodes of Animalogic every other week. Thanks for watching!